sessions have been, your body has been refreshed and your mind is ready to go again. We've had some really stellar conversations this morning, and we want to continue that. This is the Union EDIA Initiatives Seismic Pressure. I'm Tim Dang. I'm the one of the board members of the Consortium of the Asian American Theater and Artists, and thank you so much for coming. We're thrilled to have our distinguished panel here speak about initiatives at SDC, AEA, and IATSE. IATSE, and how we can advance a more diverse membership. So just a few housekeeping things first. Take a look around you for the nearest available emergency exit, should we need to exit. Okay. Also, if you want to tweet out.
And let's have some fun.
Hashtag CAATAOSF. I find it very, very useful in terms of using tweets, because then I find out what's happening at the other panels too, because there are four other panels, great panels happening at this time. So if you kind of like read the feed, you can find out what other people are thinking. So anyway, we're going to start out with our distinguished guests giving probably maybe a 4-minute introduction, name, affiliation, a short description of the work you do as it relates to EDIA initiatives. Okay, so I'm gonna start first person on my left.
My name's Radar Bateman. I'm an international representative with the IA or IASE or IATSE or International Alliance of Theatrical Stage Employees. The IA was founded in 1893, so we're over 100 years old. And we are the union that represents the people that work behind entertainment. So designers, stagehands, camera operators in motion picture, all the way up to box office and ticket sellers and front of house staff. So pretty much anybody behind entertainment that makes entertainment happen, we're the union that represents those individuals.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. Shall I go ahead?
Yes.
All right. I'm Gail Gabler, and I'm the Western Regional Director of Actors Equity Association, which is, I think most of you know, the union for professional actors and stage managers in the U.S. We have 50,000 members, and if I might, I just wanted to see how many equity members we might have in the audience. Could I ask? Oh, not a ton, but great to see you. I'll talk a little bit about our work on diversity. Diversity and inclusiveness in theater has been an important part of who Equity is from the beginning, and we were founded in not quite as early as IATSE, but 1913, so we've been around over 100 years too. And during that time, we've fought hard against segregation, against blacklisting, for gay marriage, against yellowface. On most issues dealing with diversity, our union has had a strong position on that. And yet still, the theater is not as diverse as we all want it to be. So the work is not done. I think I might have enough copies for everybody here. Those of you who are members might have already received a copy, but if you get it online and you want the hard copy, this is our most recent quarterly magazine, Equity News. And the title of this issue and the focus was Change the Stage. So it's really all about diversity, and I just love the cover picture. So I'm going to show it because we've got the camera there. And there are stories in here from many of our members talking about their experiences in getting cast or not getting cast, and stereotypes that they've faced as they've been either asked to take on roles or told they weren't right for a role. And it's really fascinating, the stories to hear from our members, which I think is an important part of helping to change the stage, is by lifting up and bringing those stories to bear and say, this is a real experience that people are having in today's America, is that they are being typecast and they're being told you're not right for this, you're too ethnic. The stories are really, in some cases, heartbreaking, and in some cases, really very inspirational of how our members have overcome that. To really do outstanding work. So I will share these as maybe we can just pass these, or should we wait till the end so people aren't flipping through? Okay. also want to share before we turn over to Laura, in terms of our union's continuing to commitment to this, our National Council of Elected Actors and Stage Managers, who are leaders in our union, met earlier this year in a plenary a couple of days in New York to get together and talk about where do we see ourselves going and what's our strategic direction for the next few years. And I'm just going to read one part of their resolution on that. The council met in plenary session and number one, affirmed that promoting equal opportunity, diversity, gender parity, and inclusion in our organizing, representation, communication, and education work shall be a top priority of our union. So that statement sort of overlaid all of our other strategic goals for the next couple of years is really based on we want to see a more inclusive theater world. So that's really our goal, and we'll have a chance to talk more about that as we go ahead.
Great, thank you.
I'm Laura Penn. I'm the executive director of the Stage Directors and Choreographers Society, the national union that represents stage directors working in jurisdictions all around the country, from Broadway to dinner theater. We like to think it's hard to find a professional production that doesn't have one of our members on it, is what we like to say. It's very dense. We're the young ones on the block. We're about 55 years old. SDC is actually the last labor union representing folks in the entertainment industry. We also have had a long-term commitment to trying to advance equity and diversity in the theater, and it's come in cycles. I think many people in the room have been part of the cycles. Certainly there was the buildup in the late 80s that came around following the release of Workforce 2000. Some changes happened then, goes quiet, comes back up, goes quiet, comes back up. Most recently in the last few years, we were challenged by some members of our union. Some of our members came forward and said, you need to be doing more. SDC needs to be doing more. They wrote a letter to the board, and the board responded. I think what's interesting for this discussion is to just take a moment and talk about the structure of a labor union, which is a little different than maybe the nonprofit organization that many of us are accustomed to, and I came from the nonprofit sector into the labor community, in that it's not top-down, it's bottom-up. So the members drive the agenda for the union. Certainly there's leadership, and leadership has a lot of influence, and leadership can make a huge difference, but leadership cannot act unilaterally. So some union members came forward about 4 years ago and said, we need more. We need more from our union in terms of diversity. The board responded very positively, and we began a process that has included the creation of a statement, not unlike equity, but also a series of actions that have been taking place over the last couple of years. And we can talk more about that in, I think, my 4 minutes. I don't want to go too far, but it's really been great to see the union feel safe enough to start to ask the questions of its membership. About 2 years ago, we did a survey because we'd put together a committee. The committee was going to put together a plan. The committee said, whoa, we got to ask the membership. We have to make sure. We're the Diversity and Inclusion Committee. We know what we want. What do the 3,000 members want? So they sent out a survey that said, how important are issues of diversity and inclusion? Should union resources be spent on issues of diversity and inclusion? And the membership could have said, not very important, and no, don't spend my money, because we're funded by our members' dues and assessment. And instead, overwhelmingly, it was absolutely, it is critical that SDC take a leadership role in these issues across the field, and yes, we want resources dedicated to this. So that's a real turning point for us that has sort of fueled the last couple of years and will continue to propel us forward.
Hi, my name is Che Yu. I'm the Artistic Director of Victory Gardens Theater in Chicago. I'm also on the Executive Board of SDC. Laura has just filled you in what SDC is, so I'm done.
That's it? Oh my gosh, okay.
It's a union panel, right?
Yeah. Well, brevity. Yeah. Brevity is always very.
Into the issues.
Yes, so let's get into the issues. So my idea is to go ahead and pose some questions to our panel. maybe for the next 15 minutes, but then the rest of the time is from you in terms of having discourse and questions about what the union can do for you and how that relates to diversity, inclusion, access issues. Okay, so, and also just to remind everyone that we are being live streamed. So just to let everyone know if they are okay with being photographed as well. I know that the Brad was taking photographs earlier, and we are being live streamed. This is going to be recorded for future viewing. Gail has also sent a link, right, to our note taker, Nicholas. Nicholas, raise your hand. To our note taker, Nicholas, via Twitter, of a panel that happened, a similar panel that happened in New York that was hosted by Christine Toy Johnson.
That's right.
So, you know, please feel free to take a look at that video as well. So my first question is, are there statistics made available as to the demographics in your union?
Yes. yes, there are. And this is actually part of the survey. I've been at SDC for 9 years. When I arrived at SDC, there were no demographic stats kept. You know, it was kind of an antiquated database. But more than that, the union never really asked. We didn't even ask gender. It was sort of guessed as it was put in the system. So needless to say, if we didn't know if you were a man or a woman, we probably didn't know anything else about you. That's changing. We've upgraded all of our systems. We've surveyed the membership several times. About 45% of our membership has self-identified with demographic information. We have 30% women, 70% men. So that's the 45% gives us enough to be an accurate sampler. So 30% women, 70% men, 11% artists of color.
Great. And so if we wanted to call the office, a member wanted to call the office and ask, you know, if there, is there a way that we could get a hold of demographics that it would be able to be shared with them?
I just shared it on Al.
Okay.
So
okay.
My Al,
so. No, to go even further in terms of a deeper dive.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, yes.
Okay.
Meaning how the artist of color breaks down, is that what you're getting at, Tim?
Yeah.
Like how many African American, how many Asian, how many?
Yeah, I mean, yes. Okay, all right. And Gail?
We put some demographic information in our annual report. I don't have a copy of our annual report here right now, but that annual report is available to all of our members.
Okay.
We are, I think, much more evenly split between women and men in equity. And I think we have a higher number of people of color, but I do not have the stats.
Great, wonderful. Radar.
And for the IA, currently, the information that we collect is through the application for membership, and the question it just asks your name, your address, and your phone number. It doesn't collect that information currently, so the IA doesn't have that.
Well, I think it's a good point that I think all of this is, you know, self-identifying, and whether people choose to self-identify or not, we don't have any way to, you know, and none of us have a way to automatically determine that among our memberships. It's what information our membership shares with us.
Right. Okay. Jay, anything to add to that question?
No.
Great. Thank you so much for the quick answers. Oh my gosh.
So we can get to the Q&A part.
Exactly. Okay, so next question. What are some very insightful thoughts about how unions can uncover pay inequities and right those situations? Research shows that workers of color and women are paid less. People of color work less. How do we get this data and help unions encourage diversity?
I'll go.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go on that one.
Go for it.
So I think one thing that unions do help on pay inequity is the fact that during, say, an organizing process, when a group of technicians, I work in the live entertainment department, I don't know if I said that during my introduction, but so I work with primarily stagehands or people backstage, wardrobe. But during when we're organizing crew and we've collected did the what's called the we collect cards, we go through a petition with the NLRB. We're able to then, during the negotiation process, we're able to ask for information from the employer. And I think what's important is the transparency that happens at that point. And how many of you know how much your coworker makes? Like, you don't, I mean, probably. And so that allows employers to discriminate or be unfair because they don't have to pay everybody the same. When you're able to negotiate a contract, you're able to really make that transparency happen and be able to create a level playing field. And you're also able to look at the way people are promoted within a company or on the job. And so there's non-arbitrary ways that you can do that based on skills or demonstration, and it's not based on, oh, do I like you, or are you the nice person, or do you come into work early, or such. No, it's you performed your job, you had the skills, you've been there the longest. It's non-arbitrary, and we're able to put that in a collective bargaining agreement. So I think that really definitely helps in eliminating the discrimination that happens in the job place.
Okay, great, thanks. Kim?
Yeah, I'd like to build a little bit on what Radar is saying. I mean, the importance of having a labor union. So many studies have shown that in the general population in America, the discrepancy between what you make and as a person of color versus what a Caucasian person makes, the gap there is decreased, not based on education, not based on seniority. The biggest determinant of having more equal pay is belonging to a labor union. So that's in all professions across our economy. So belonging to a labor union is what helps to close that gap, in addition to making it more transparent. So in our union for on stage, all of our members, regardless of their background, make the same minimums, that they are guaranteed the same minimums in the contract that employer agreement is under. Now, we do not govern above the minimum, so there are some of our members who might have just won a Tony Award who might say, you know what, you're gonna pay me a little bit more than that, right? Or they're a TV star in addition to their stage work and they, you know, are the big draw for bringing the audiences in. But in terms of knowing what your coworkers are making, you know, in the cast, you do know that when you're on a union contract, an equity contract, and I think that's true for all of ours, that it sort of eliminates that bit of disparity. The other issue, though, of course, is getting the jobs in the first place, and I think we're going to get back into that issue as well.
You know, it truly is the great leveler, right? Because you know nobody's in the room that isn't at least at this baseline. I think what's also maybe less known is in the negotiating process when you're trying to improve conditions and protections. It's the strongest members that are at those tables. And the strongest members often are the ones that are working for above minimum. So when you sit in, whether it's a LORT negotiation or a Broadway negotiation or an off-Broadway negotiation, you know, it's Jerry Mitchell that's fighting to increase the minimums. And, you know, Jerry Mitchell's fine, but he's working for the next that follows. So it's sort of it embedded in the labor negotiation process and the collective bargaining agreements is a kind of, you know, it really is one for all. And it's about lifting everyone.
Okay.
All I can say is
I've never seen Chase so silent.
I think we belong to the same union. It would be just, you know, we will just be duplicated. As an artist of color, I mean, when I get an SDC contract, I know I'm not being underpaid because we have fought to make sure that everything that you are signing off on is equitable. So that is less, like what we've been saying, the union has been there fighting for all of us. The question then becomes at one point, what is the entry point? And I don't know what the union can do about this,
right,
but I'm sure that we're all trying to figure out ways of access and to create equity amongst everyone.
Great. So I'm actually going to get back to you, Jay, you know, in a question later on, because there are organizations like Victory Gardens and like OSF that have special policies or a mandate in terms of equity and access and inclusion. And you know, how can other theaters kind of like follow that lead, which would be really great. Let us continue. How can we work with employers as unions to grow the employment for underrepresented groups and support more artists of color, women, and other underrepresented groups? I'm hoping that we can have at least a takeaway where we can check back with you in a year and go, did this happen?
Sure.
You know? And I know it's a working,
issue. The guiding principles of our diversity and inclusion work, the committee, is the idea of connectivity, communication, and jobs. So that we are not, we decide very early on not to replicate the work of others, but to rather connect with allies, is a word that's been used in the last few days, and I think is apt, whether it's TCG, LORT, whether it's this group, the National Black Theater Festival, the Latina Commons, to be able to make those connections and figure out how to reinforce some of the aspirations of those groups and inform our own work. Communicate, keep communication open at all times and very transparent with the membership. And then to focus on jobs. We are a union fundamentally, it is about jobs. So how do we end up increasing the employment in an environment of, as Michael John Garces says, of scarcity? There aren't very many jobs, really, for directors. You know, there are, 2,200 contracts a year. 1.8 contract per member that files every year. So, we're talking about just over 1,000 jobs. It's unlike equity or the stagehands, but they are very important, very influential. Jobs both with respect to the aesthetic and the work and the craft and issues of diversity and inclusion. So just because we have very few jobs doesn't mean we underestimate the influence and the value of those jobs. But our work is beginning sort of internally with the board and the organization itself to understand as much as we can about our membership, who they are, when they work, when they don't work, what the conditions of that employment is in terms of repetition and other things, so that we can then grow the membership, make ourselves more accessible to more artists of color, and we can move our members up through the levels of employment. One of the things we're working on, I don't know if it'll be done in the next year, Tim, but is a convening. It's easy to talk about high school and encouraging young high school students to get interested in theater. We've been talking about that for 30 years, and frankly, to some degree, it's working. For example, I'll speak with directing students from graduate programs around the country all throughout the year, and they're not homogenous anymore, those groups of directors. There's some success in recruiting. We need to make sure they have jobs that can support lives and families as they start to move up the food chain. And there's a barrier, it's very clear, between the nonprofit and the commercial sector. There's a very, very thick ceiling. And how can we help introduce producers, maybe to established directors of color who are currently working that have not been introduced to that tier of producers? How can we help encourage young producers in the commercial sector of color, women producers? How can we make matches, between younger producers and this tier of artists? So our work, yes, we have our foundation programs. We're continuing to increase the numbers of opportunities and shift the demographics of that group. But it's not just about the emerging. For us, it's about the established. And it's about having the full complement of directing and choreographing opportunities open to the full breadth of talent.
Great.
Well, I'll just piggyback on what Laura says. I mean, on the practical side, because she's telling you stuff that probably is what we do, but on the practical side, one of them probably would be the observership program that we have. And I think if you were here earlier, some of the directors had mentioned that it was an opportunity for them to get an inroad, and Desimone basically said 3 or 4 years later she got a job. And I've always been someone who had an observer from the SDC. And the 27% of our applicants are people of color, and 40% of the mentors are actually directors of color. And having a few of these young people come through, young artists come through, I finally hired one in Chicago, a young woman who's going to be directing my next season. So one way the union can affect practical things into, I would say, institutional practice is actually the observership program. So
let me ask you this question that seems very appropriate, Che. So you are a director that gets employed at other theaters, but you also are the artistic director of your own theater, so you get to employ people, right? So I am just wondering in terms of what is it that, I don't want to say that other theaters need to do, but how does that leadership, and I would also say that Bill Rausch is also on that same level in terms of where he directs and also hires, is it the leadership that is open to the philosophy of diversity and inclusion?
Yeah.
I were you hired at Victory Gardens for that fact of, you know, because obviously you went in and you said, you know, this is my vision for the next 5 years or, you know.
Yeah. I think it's twofold, right? I mean, one is you believe in it, and then you open the doors. Sharing power is very difficult for people who have power. Number two, if your leadership is of color, automatically you do what you think is most, well, what's second skin. So when they came in to ask for, you know, looking at applicants for artistic directors, obviously they were looking for a change. I was also very surprised that they were thinking of something very out of the box. But the three finalists, two were people of color, of which I'm one. And it also took a female headhunter, a female, I would say, headhunter, basically, to look for other candidates which are not traditionally white and male. So the question is, what are the ceilings? How you get to a certain place? And for me, once I go into Victory Gardens, you know, you're getting a whole lot of me. And the whole lot of me means the philosophies in which I believe, and we are going to starting with practice, and the board has never wavered. The board has changed its makeup. We have, I'm surprised, for a theater in Chicago, 5 Asian Americans on our board, you know, 4 or 5 African Americans on our board, and more women than I've started with, because it used to be 85% white men. It's now changed. Same thing with staff, and it gets tricky too. I would say the struggle is always just to say, how do you find the best people and also keep diversity at bay? You just don't want to also say, I'm only going for diversity. You want to find the best person for the job. So it's always that question. We look at that through casting, we look at that through everything, and it's been, I would say, complicated. It's been a lot of work, but a lot of great work. And what is interesting about Chicago is, once someone's doing something, everybody wants to do it too. So I'm very proud that even in the city, I hope it's not a trend, but it's a fundamental philosophy, fundamental belief that diversity actually creates a better working environment and better art. So we look at The Goodman, the season is wonderfully diverse. Look at Hypocrites, a white theater company traditionally, ensemble, who's now open to female directors and directors of color all season. Even Writers Theater is doing the first Julius Caesar with a non-traditional cast. So things are happening. But I think in the end, if I were to say, the question then becomes, who is leading the field? Are we grooming leaders for the next generation who are going to be able to open doors a lot more than what our generation has? There's only one Bill Rausch. I wish there were 100. But it was also Bill Rausch that let me direct the play at Cornerstone that got me probably sitting here and doing a play at OSF. It was also Gordon Davidson who passed away, who said, here's a door. And it's not a seat at the fucking table. You know, a seat at the table we can always get, but at the end of the meal, you're going home. Otherwise, you're sweeping. It's to determine the menu. It's to determine which guests are you inviting in. And it's on this, I think on the shoulders of these wonderful leaders that we are here today. And the work is not done. The units are doing their best. The question then becomes, how can we evolve the next generation of leaders? Are you ready? It's not as simple as the doors open, you walk in, if you're not ready. So I'm hoping that the unions, I know especially as SEC, we're trying to give the next generation of artists and leaders enough experience to lead a theater, to open more doors for different stories to be told. And even today's panel, which I kind of love, you know, they're like, to me, a different generation of directors in the last panel. I see the future. Eric is leading a theater company. I can't, will not believe that Desdemona won in 10 years. The doors will continue to open. Mika, bright shining light. I see big things for her. These are your allies. These are your artists, and this is the American theater today and tomorrow.
I too would echo that Gordon Davidson had, you know, quite an impact on my career as well, as I was operating East West Players, and you need to say something?
Yes, I'm sorry, Tim. Thank you too. It's a long fuzzy history. I mean, without Tim doing my plays when I was a kid in LA, I probably wouldn't be sitting here. If Tim wanted to do three plays of mine, of which were gay Asian content, two board members wanted to walk up. He stood by me. He also let me direct, and TCG too gave me a grant. So all these things help. There are avenues, there are ways. Finding your own homes, wonderful things, and having people who open those doors. So once you walk through the doors, it is your responsibility at some point to open them up for the next generation. Then we can get a more inclusive, equitable, diverse America on our stages and in our theaters.
Right. Well said, well said. And with that, I'd like to open it up to all of you, but first have Mika actually say something as that next generation that is being groomed by Bill.
No? Hi.
Not yet. Not yet.
Okay. Not yet. On the spot.
A little later.
Okay. Yeah.
A little later or no?
Yeah. A little later is okay.
Okay. All right. So let's open this up to everyone. Come on, don't be shy. Leslie.
When I think about the unions and my own experience as an actor, now stage director, an actor on screen and on stage, and then a stage director in the union, one of the things that I'm challenged by is bias. How do we keep figuring out how to deal with bias? And Laura, you and I have had a conversation about the observership is so powerful for folks. But even if the pool has directors of color in it, they don't stay in the pool until they get matched. Mm-hmm. If you don't get chosen or matched, they start a new round, you're done, and you have to reapply. So that leaves such room for bias, and I'm sure there's other programs that are similar. That just illuminated that for me. Is there a way that we make sure with those programs, people of color that were nominated and got in, actually stay in until they get a match? And how are we working on the other side to make sure that match happens? And again, I'm sure there's other programs as well where we're trying to figure out matches or pipelines, and it just doesn't quite happen, so then, well, next round. Do you know what I mean? And I see there's bias there that really has to get dealt with. I have bias, you know, mm-hmm. The lens, how do we open that up, really confront our own blind spots, if you will.
Well, the program that Leslie's speaking of, our observership program, is an opportunity to get emerging and early career directors into the rehearsal hall with master artists. And we do about 30 of these a year all over the country in all jurisdictions. We have about 400 plus directors, choreographers that apply every year. We have a process whereby that gets narrowed to about 100 that become the class for that year. The applications are actually, the application process has been developing over the last few years, and each of those 400 are reviewed by, you know, I mean, we have like 48 members that review those applications. So we're trying to
filter those through a real wide variety of, and it's all done online now. It used to be you had to come into New York, sit at the table, do it. So it, who could do that was limited. It's not now because it's online. So the 48 observership evaluators this year were very eclectic and diverse. And the piles went around in a way that made sure that everybody's seen by three people. You know, then there's a final pass through staff to make sure that somebody hasn't been excluded from the 100 for some reason that doesn't seem appropriate. So the pool is 100. Those folks are given opportunities during the year, first of all, to gather and get help writing artistic statements and some other, you know, career development things. But these 30 mentors agree to have someone in the rehearsal hall with them. They say, here's what I need. Susan Sturman will say, it'd be great if it's somebody who had ballet experience. Somebody else will say, it'd be great if it had somebody, whatever. We tell the 100 observers, you know, Che wants somebody who can tap dance. Or understands the history of tap. You're not a choreographer, that didn't make sense, but that's okay. So then you write and you say, dear Che, I wanna be with you because. And then Che interviews five of those. Now, Che may have 35 of the 100 that apply to be with him. Or Che may have, five that apply to be with him. But he agrees to at least speak with five of those folks that have come through and consider those five. Now, all of those five get a professional experience, right? Because they're all getting interviewed. They've already been seen by several other leaders across the country. Now they're all being interviewed by Che. Only one's gonna get in the rehearsal hall. So that the experience of being in the pool actually in and of itself is an experience because you're getting training and writing artistic statements, you're meeting people, you're engaged. You may not end up being one of the 30. That's true. But we don't place the observer. So the mentor hires, you know, selects their own person because we can't, you know, the foundation staff, we can't presume to make those decisions because it's a rehearsal hall. It's a very intimate relationship that a director has to someone who's in the rehearsal hall. And that goes on for a year and then we do it again the next year. And you're welcome to apply again. Some people are in the pool multiple years, some people don't apply again. I don't know that we've ever thought about sort of pulling some folks out of the pool and having them. It's an interesting question you ask. I think the thing we've been working on is making sure that we get rid of those biases at the front end.
Well, to that point, how do you select the directors that will be the mentors? Because I would probably venture to guess if it's primarily white directors, they
it's
may not.
40%.
And how is that growing to be at least 51%?
Well, it's, you know, I will say that 8 years ago it was about 10%. So, you know, it
is. Is there particular recruitment or actions you all take?
There is a foundation committee and the executive board of SDC, yeah. Which actually today is about 35% artists of color on the executive board. I think that the growth has been pretty consistent.
Well, the other thing to Leslie is like, you know, I mean, of all the four observers I had, two are of color. The other two I didn't go is because I felt whoever I needed in the room, for example, certain skills, you're right. Not tap dancing, could be something else. But if that certain director could actually help in the room, and also for me to help that person. For example, if it could be an Asian American director with classical training, I don't know what I can do except that if it's an Asian American director who wanted to learn how new plays were being made, more specifically, that's a great match. Then I can help more. So sometimes there are these variables. I'm not sure, I think numbers are great, but in the end, if 40% of the mentors are of color and 27 were chosen, there was some of the directors probably were choosing outside of their, you know, cultural group, mm-hmm. So.
You know, our business, like this, we were talking earlier, like if you're a stagehand, you can be tested, you know, on your rigging skills, and you can kind of pass a You know,
yeah, it's skill based.
Yeah,
you have to be. It is measurable. Yeah, and so it is much different than artistic. There is artistic craft to it, but it is skill based. Everett, did you?
It feels like there are things being done at SDC that was really clear. At least with Equity, we got the sense that you had some numbers and you were paying attention. And what I got from the technical union was that you don't even have the numbers. So I'm curious about what kind of programs you're doing, because as a freelance director, I get dropped into very white technical spaces all the time. Mm-hmm. I know my designer friends feel very similarly. And so we're actually have, as we're talking about leadership change and artist change, we've sort of, the container, the people who are making it happen are not actually of those backgrounds, but also are not culturally competent in that way in terms of how some of those conversations get led. So I'm just curious about some of your programs, if there are any.
I can tell you that currently we have a young workers program that focuses in on young workers under 35 in the industry. At our conference that we just had, the diversity in that room was huge. I mean, you could see it. You can. It was not just white men in that room. The upper leadership of the IA, I mean, they have, you know, the skills. They've been there, but they're not always going to be there. So change is coming. It's just it may not be as fast as one may want to see. But it is happening.
Gail, you wanted to add?
Sorry, what?
Gail, did you want to add something?
Well, I wanted to actually touch a little bit on that issue, because I think the issue of, we have an EEO committee at Equity that's very, very active, and Christine Troy Johnson was, I think, originally really wanted to be here to speak to this and was delighted that we could be represented. And so they work a lot on access and kind of dealing with this this bias that isn't always, you know, so obvious, but is there, and that people definitely, you know, experience when they go and get, you know, get cast as an actor or get hired as a stage manager. But then your point also calls on, well, what happens afterwards when you actually do have the job? And I think that's another place where having a union is very important, because fighting discrimination on your own when you don't have a union is a lot harder. If you're actually experiencing some kind of discrimination, I mean, unions do not sort of, you know, snap our fingers and make it go away, or it would be gone. But at least it's some place to go and feel that you have some rights. And one of the stories that, you know, was really moving to me in this issue on the change of the stage was one of our stage managers who said, when I am offered a job and it's outside my city, I will ask, tell me what the experience is going to be like for me as a gay black man in your town. And he said, if the answer is, then that's all I need to know. So that's even beyond just the workplace. It's like, what is it going to be like in the place that you are going? Because sometimes you can have a theater that is very committed to diversity, and you can have a director who is, you know, is hiring diverse cast and doing plays that, you know, have diverse characters. And, you know, hopefully the audiences are coming in, but if the community is not a place where the artists feel safe, that's an issue that we want to address as a union, to help our members to do their best work. So there are so many layers of issues that we have to deal with. But I do want to say one other piece of how we sort of tackle the bias thing as Equity is we have access to, for Equity theaters, for those theaters that actually have an agreement, a seasonal agreement with Actors Equity, they are required to post their audition notices. So at least for hiring actors and stage managers, right, for casting and hiring stage managers, they are required to put those notices out. So if they're putting a notice out saying, like, you know, only Caucasian white men need apply, it's like, no, that's, you know, so we can filter out some of that obvious bias in terms of what the audition notices are putting out there, and, you know, we do not allow that to sort of pass muster. So that's one layer of trying to cut back that bias. But it's one thing to say everybody can apply and we're looking for anyone. It's another thing to actually say, yeah, you've auditioned, but are you going to get the job? So one thing Christine Toy Johnson, the EEO committee, have actually worked on is going beyond non-discrimination to embracing non-traditional casting. And a number of our agreements actually now include a sort of proactive positive statement about non-traditional casting, which sort of goes beyond just, we won't not hire you because you're a person of color or a woman or have a disability. It actually says you will, here, I'll just read a couple pieces of it if I can. The parties affirm their commitment to an inclusive casting policy known as non-traditional casting for the purpose of increasing employment for actors of color, women, seniors, and performers with disabilities, and is defined as the casting of such performers in roles where race, gender, age, ethnicity, or the presence or absence of a disability is not germane to either the play or the character's development. So if Martin Luther King has to be an African-American man, yeah, you're gonna cast an African-American man in that, we would assume in most versions of plays about Martin Luther King. But in other plays, you don't necessarily need to have what maybe even the playwright thought. Maybe you don't need to have that on stage. So actually asking producers in terms of what their overall policy is going to be to overcome that bias, you know, to sort of conceptually agree to non-traditional casting is part of where we're trying to go. The difficulty is that individual decision that an individual producer makes about, well, this show I kind of had a certain type in mind, and that is much harder to root out. So programs like what SDC is doing and the kinds of conversations like we're having right here is really important to continue that conversation.
Okay. Mika and then Lily.
I have a couple questions as a producer, but before I get to those, a couple things. So I think it's really important for you all as unions to have an analysis on the ways that bias presents itself, right? So white supremacy, for example, it shapeshifts. And if the leadership of the unions are white, and they don't have an anti-bias or anti-racist analysis, you can't begin to think of ways in which you can employ different practices and policies, right, to dismantle those things. So I guess that's a ploy for some kind of development and training for the leadership of the unions, and also, you know, just an observation that the leadership is often predominantly white or predominantly, you know, male or predominantly something, right? And so that diversity is important. So I have two issues as a producer, and I want to talk about casting. I'm so glad that you talked about non-traditional casting, and I want to say that I think that that committee that you're talking about should revise its language, because I think that non-traditional is actually not very inclusive. But oftentimes I hear from directors and I hear from writers that they're frustrated that they are unable to cast individuals from their ethnicity in their plays. And what I mean by that is Asians, for example, are not monolithic, right? And so I have Korean playwrights who say to me, I have never had Koreans in my play about Koreans. I've always had Japanese people, or, right? And so it's very challenging for me, because as a producer, I can't lead with that kind of specificity, precisely because of the practices, procedures and policies that you're talking about. But I do need help, right, in terms of being able to find the artists so that we can produce the work as authentically as possible. And that is, you know, that's working toward a high level of specificity and inclusion. So any remarks you have about that would be great. And then Radar, I'd love to hear, you know, I think we have to acknowledge in this room that both of those unions were founded during Jim Crow, right? So institutions that were founded during that time, if you don't have active anti-racism policies in place, they're not just gonna change over time. They're not just gonna change because of population shifts in America. So you actively have to, you have to dismantle, right, the foundations of that organization.
Sorry, can I just add something onto that? because I think this issue of language is really important, the non-traditional. And also, when we talk about emergent, I think these really smart pipelines are wonderful and the mentoring is really wonderful. But it also just reinforces a kind of infantilism, a kind of less than, a kind of second class citizenship in terms of the arts community. And for me, having been on panels where, you know, people were trying to identify an emerging early career director for certain fellowships, there was always a bias towards institutionally trained MFA directors, oftentimes who had very little actual body of work, but had assisted this person, this person, this person, mm-hmm. and an exclusion of other directors who may not have been through that type of training system, but actually had done plays. Do you know what I mean? So I think that those issues of bias work in many different ways, and the language is really important, but also the approach, so that we're not always emergent.
Yeah, so last January, the IAK made an equality statement, so we have a statement out there. And at that board meeting, the president, two vice presidents retired, and the president appointed for the IA appointed two women, one of color. So we're working on trying to include diversity at the IA at the upper management level. And I guess, you know, that is definitely a focus of the current president, the current leadership.
If I could respond to the question about if you were talking about the was it the playwright who was looking for his or her play to be performed by Korean artists? Is that
yes?
Was it the playwright? Yes. So so there's a difference between a casting notice talking about a character and talking about an actor, and what our union's practice is to not want you to specify who the actor has to be, but you can say who the character is. So if the character is a Korean middle-aged, you know, woman, that's fine in the breakdown to specify that that's who the character is, as opposed to saying we're looking for X kind of people to play that role.
Yeah, but I saw a white person walk in who believes they look Asian and have played Asians in the past, and they will audition, right, based on that. So that's actually not sufficient.
Well, the interesting thing is I will tell you that we have seen casting notices where people will say exactly that. Will say, looking for Asian or Caucasian. So it's like, well, so you're basically inviting Caucasian. That is something that we don't like to see. We don't like to see you saying, here's who we'll take to play this. So in other words, say who the character is, and then when people come in and say, yeah, I'm going to audition for that part, then you're going to decide whether or not you're going to cast that person.
Yeah, but I think you're missing my point. That person could come in. I have no way of knowing, right, what ethnicity they are. They could not be Korean. They could be white. It doesn't matter if you put it in the character breakdown because of the history, right, of how Asians have been portrayed in various art forms. So unless, as a producer, I'm able to say, I want Korean actors and actresses for these parts, anybody in their mama could come in and play those roles, right? And then I'm put in a very awkward position where I am determining what people's ethnic identity is, and that's problematic, right? Folks need to be able to, but I have to assume, like I can't ask the white person who wants to come in and play that role, are you actually Korean? And if I decide that they're Korean, you know, it's complicated. So being able to lead with a high level of specificity, mm-hmm. I think is important. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
It is complicated, I agree with you on that. There's a slippery slope if you want to start specifying that I really want to have a Korean actor play this role, because we don't want you to come in and say this is a Caucasian role and we want a Caucasian to play it. And we are really trying to sort of break down that wall. So that's the difficulty there. But I agree, it's a complicated situation as we're trying to get more diverse and inclusive performances on stage.
Lily. So I have a couple of questions. I'm an equity actor, and namely for Gail. So a couple of my first question is, In terms of the numbers, the statistics of how many people of color or a certain ethnicity of actors are hired under equity contracts, is that the numbers you're saying are in your annual report? Or is that the statistics of the membership?
Yeah, and because I don't have this, I'm sorry, because the preparation for this was a little truncated, I don't have all those information, so I can't tell you exactly what the annual report says. I don't think it's the number of hired, I think it's the number of members.
Okay, because I asked because, I feel like for many years, different people in the community have tried to get those numbers from a gender standpoint and how many contracts a year go out to women, and also how many contracts a year go out to certain ethnic actors. And that's been, no one has been able to get the numbers. Like, Equity just won't release them, even though those questions are asked when you sign your contract, what actors are giving that information to Equity. So I'm wondering why, those statistics would be really, really helpful in amongst the groups of us who are activists in equity in theater, and I'm wondering why we can't get access to those numbers. And I've tried to get them as an actor, I've tried to get them as a journalist because I was an arts journalist for many years, and I both of those positions I've not been able to get them. And other people that I know who fight for gender parity or who are African American theater activists, they also have not been able to get them.
So are you talking about gender issues particularly, or ethnic breakdowns, or what are you?
Any of those statistics of how many contracts, if you looked at the contracts at large for the year, what percentage are going to men, what percentage are going to women? That's one question. And then if you look at the contracts per year, what percentage are going to Caucasian actors, what percentage are going to Asian American actors, or people identify that way, what percentage are going to African American actors? Because those questions are asked by Equity of their actors we don't have to give the information,
but we ask
that, what do you identify as? And I put Asian American, or I'm a woman, So if that information is out there, and it seems like from my conversations with Equity or the administration there that there's some collation of that data. I for many years, I would say for the last more than 5 years, between 5 and 10 years, I and other people in the community, both in the Bay Area where I'm from and nationally, have tried to get those numbers, and Equity has always said no.
Okay, well, I'm not sure the reason for that. I do know that particularly, although we've had sort of really 100 years of working on these kinds of issues, and including against Jim Crow, and just sort of historically, but it is something that's such a high priority for our union right now, and you heard me read sort of our plenary statement on that. So part of what actually the EEO committee is doing right now is a series of focus groups across the country and talking with our members in all three regions of the country, and particularly talking with artists of color, and finding out more than sort of the anecdotes that we have in the news magazine, which is great, but more in-depth conversations with groups of members to talk about sort of what their experiences are. And I have no doubt that this issue will come up, but we want to know what the results are, mm-hmm. How many there are of us, and how many of us are getting jobs, and where are we getting jobs, et cetera. So I think that's probably something that our council will be looking at in terms mm-hmm. of, both what do we need to be doing and what's the data that we need to be looking at.
Because, just from a gender parity standpoint, just that data for how many contracts women are actually getting, it's so valuable in that fight to get gender parity on stage. So that was if that could be communicated to leadership, that would be great. The other question I have is, for example, in SAGs, I'm also a member of SAG-AFTRA, there are contracts in SAG, I don't know about the large contracts, but for independent films and such, there are contracts which say you can work under this, you can do a film under this contract if you have a certain percentage of actors of color in this production. And I'm wondering if that's something that Equity can do.
Well, you can work under any contract with performers of color.
No. I'm saying there are certain contracts that are available to filmmakers that they can only get. They can only get this better contract.
Like a lower paying contract?
Maybe they can have a higher budget if, I don't know the exact, I don't have it in front of me, but there's
incentive.
It's an incentive to hire actors of color because, I'm not sure if it, I only noticed the ones that are relevant to actors of color. There may be some relevant to gender parity as well, but there are some smaller contracts for independent films where you can have access to this type of contract as a producer if you have a certain percentage of actors of color in your film. So it incentivizes producers to hire actors of color because then they can
pay less.
Yeah, that's what I'm worried about.
I'm not sure if it's paying less though. It may just be the budgetary limit.
Who's giving the incentive though? I mean, so like in film work, a lot of incentives come through state initiatives and state gives kickbacks, whether it be that they have to hire local hires in order to get a tax break, or whether it, so it may not necessarily be the union that has control over that incentive, the incentive that you're talking about. So I'm wondering about that, because really, from my standpoint, the IA is out there trying to make sure everybody's getting paid the same. Like, I was just set through negotiations ahead, and I was able to look at the payroll sheets and see that somebody on that sheet was paid $2 an hour less an hour for their work, doing the same work, but I mean, could see that they weren't the same because they didn't have a Caucasian name. Like, you could tell that the name was not a white name, a non-white name. And so, through the negotiation process, though, we were able to make the rate for everybody the same at the end of the day.
Well, I think all the actors in that film have the same rate.
Okay.
You're talking about whether the producer has access to that contract. So
right.
It's not that
the film actors who are people of color
would make.
Are making less. That's not what
okay.
the contract
okay.
says.
So it's not a contract that pays less.
No. It's that if you say
they wouldn't have access to because the budget is too high.
For example, like I have to look. I mean, I can look at it in the next
okay.
20 minutes we have, but essentially, like if I was gonna make a parallel to the theater world, it's like saying, you know, for example, like Barry Children's Theater in San Francisco, they don't have access to the BAT because they're like $1 million budget. That's their annual budget. So, this is like, that's kind of an extreme case. But say there was a theater who had a $500,000 budget, but they can only access the BAT if they have a $300,000 budget. But if their actors for a certain show were over whatever percentage actors of color, they could have access to that contract. I mean, everyone on the contract would be still paid the same.
I hear what you're saying,
right.
And I think that's another complicated issue because I understand what you're trying to achieve, which is you're trying to achieve more diversity and sort of incentivize it for producers who are just looking at the bottom line and who are maybe saying like, yeah, I'm going to do, you know, Mary Poppins or something. I'm going to do it with an all-white cast, and I'm going to, you know, make plenty of money in my next season. That's what I'm going to put in there, instead of something else that might be a little bit more diverse. And so how do you incentivize that? Well, if you can say you have this other contract. So your point is that all the members on it would be making the same amount, but that contract might be itself at a lower rate than the contract they should be on. So it's still a tricky issue. I hear what you're
mm-hmm.
trying to get. I mean, your goal is good, but it's a tricky thing. And frankly, we, as Equity, we have not done that. We have not said you're going to be able to sort of get this good deal for our members as long as it's the members of color, because I think that sends messages other than the one you're trying to send.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say, we do have like four different awards that are given out throughout the U.S. To theater practitioners, sometimes it's to a whole theater company, recognizing diversity. And so that's one way we do try to sort of incentivize, we try to recognize at least and sort of, you know, shine a spotlight on those who are doing a good job. And hopefully they, you know, PR the heck out of that to say we're being recognized for our work. And, you know, that's something that we can do that actually is helpful to the goal as opposed to maybe a little bit tricky.
Okay, I want to try to wrap this up because I feel like we all need a drink right now. So let's go to Lydia and then to Jennifer.
Thank you. So before I ask my question, I think I also want to you know, as a literature major, I'm very conscious of language, and, you know, I will echo Mika's point and Roberta's point about, you know, non-traditional in that kind of language and the ways in which it is exclusionary. I also want to caution us against confusing equity with equality.
Yep.
Those are two very different things. Equity presupposes from each according to their means and to each according to their needs, and recognizing that artists are not starting from the same position. So while it's admirable that once folks make it into your unions, that they are that you make every effort to treat them equitably, to try and eliminate as much explicit bias as you possibly can by trying to be transparent among your membership, I also want to recognize that sometimes that presupposes that your artists are starting from the same position, and that can actually sustain inequality in the long run. So I want to encourage you to look at, don't ignore history, and don't ignore that folks are not starting from an equal starting point. To that end, earlier, you know, you spoke about the systems that you have in place to ensure that your members have as much information among the membership to be able to know what the actor next to you is making, like to have that sense of solidarity within your unions. Can you speak to the systems that you have in place to get through that gate into that, into a system that is more equitable? Because while we were talking about bias in the sense of, you know, what happens when you have a casting breakdown that specifies, you know, we want only white actors. How are your unions preparing yourselves internally to be able to break down implicit biases, to be able to examine your structures, to train yourselves to be able to see the ways in which the structures are actually replicating in inequitable systems? And to look at the systems of biases that are often underground and sometimes internalized by people of color. So sometimes it's not enough to have people of color at your tables. How are they also complicit in sustaining problematic systems? So are you having those dialogues internally about how you're preparing yourselves for this conversation?
Yeah, I have to, you know, some of us have been doing this work for a very long time. Have seen some successes and some shortfalls, have had our own lessons, learned our own lessons, been in some very difficult discussions. So although I've been at SDC for 9 years, I've been doing this work since the early 80s and have been blessed to have been diversity and inclusion work and making theater. So it's not like this, like 4 years ago when a dozen SDC members said you should do, it was like the first time I learned how to, you know, spell anything. I mean, this has been part of my own personal journey, which I think you can't, it's a lifelong journey, right? You know, of understanding ourselves and where we're from, our own bias, being able to recognize them in others, being able to try to figure out how to transform an organization that is from the bottom up, as I said earlier, and the bottom is predominantly the dominant culture, and it's predominantly white men. Mm-hmm. And it's predominantly, in the organization I'm in, it's a commercial theater. I mean, our SDC, make no mistake about it, we represent directors and choreographers across the country, and we're doing all of this work because of 75 contracts that happen in a 10-block radius in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. So it's a very complicated, system to navigate and to try to figure out how to move it along. We have our staff, which is a fantastic staff and continues to learn and is a more diverse staff than I've ever been blessed to work with in my life. And so I learn lessons every day from many of those folks. The board, you know, I can let Chase speak to this, but the board has become much more diverse and inclusive, and I've got a board of 34 directors and choreographers, okay? And these are people working in every jurisdiction across the country at the top of their game. And they are filled with all the gifts and all the challenges that you can imagine that brings. and they are all certain they will never get hired again. You know, the life of a director in this country and a choreographer is just like that, regardless. And yet, within that, there are layers, right? So it's like, I may think I'm never going to get another job, but that's a lot different than you thinking you're never going to get another job, or radar, because we're coming from different places. So I guess the first, you know, my first impulse, my response to you is initially that this isn't a beginning. This is an end process. This isn't something that just started.
Yeah.
Lloyd Richards was the president of SDC, you know, 30 years ago. So SDC has been in this game for a long time and has been under fire because directors can make terrible mistakes or be perceived as the person that made the terrible mistake. And directors are advancing this as much as anyone else in the country. So, you know, we have our staff training, we have our board training, we have, you know, we're trying to figure out how to deal with a membership that has to change. So
here's my question. I mean, like, if you recognize that the voices around those tables where you are having this conversation are more diverse, that this has been happening for 30 years, it's been happening a long time, and yet, what I'm hearing is that the demographics of all of these different organizations, you know, of SDC, mm-hmm. of Equity, of IATSE, have remained stubbornly persistent.
We're not the employers.
We can, you know, perhaps mark successes that, like, you know, some numbers are shifting and that we're seeing mm-hmm. some progress. And yet the progress that is being made seems to be remarkably slow. So are we looking at the structures in which we're operating? Because yes,
but we're not hiring. We're not hiring. I mean, what's really an important piece there is we're not the hirers.
Mm-hmm.
We are the workforce. I mean, I do know we've discovered, for example, here's something we've discovered recently, and we're boy, it is on our our associate membership pool is 50% women, 50% men. About 35% artists of color.
Uh-huh.
Our full membership is 30% women, 70% men, 11% artists of color.
Uh-huh.
They drop off. You know why? The break point between associate and full member is getting a contract.
Yep.
So we know that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, but we're not a dispatch union.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't say, you know, take this associate and hire them,
mm-hmm.
you must.
Mm-hmm.
So what we have to do is we have to build the membership up and put the pressure from the top, all sort of simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not it's a yes and, mm-hmm. but yes, to, you know, it's a confluence of events
mm-hmm.
that take place.
But I think Lydia is talking about cultivating a diverse and qualified candidate pool,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is largely what you all do, right? You represent the members.
As a producer, there are certain spaces, right? I can only hire SDC folks, right? Or I have
mm-hmm.
to have a certain number of equity contracts. Or
mm-hmm.
we are an IATSE house now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I rely on you to create those diverse and qualified candidate pools.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, I don't think it's as benign as, I don't think you can just say, oh, we're not the employer, so.
No, but I actually would argue that this is where when somebody says we should start mentorship in high school, and I say we have a diverse and qualified candidate pool of artists of color, directors and choreographers, and they don't get the same jobs and they don't hit the next break points. So if you want to find some more directors or choreographers of color and you feel that you're not able to find them through your own networks, give us a call.
I think that's what she's talking about.
Give us a call.
Yes.
Give
exactly.
us a call.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it's just way too easy for everybody to, because I get, somebody will put pressure on an employer, and an employer will call me and say, oh, Laura, what, how many women are in, what is the, and it's like, oh, well, we hire 30% women. That's all the women you have. So I don't have to hire, I don't have to do 50-50, because your membership's only 30-70. And I say, whoa, wait a minute, no. That's not what it is. You want to qualify, you know, you can look at the women that are working at SDC and you can hire 50% to 50%.
Absolutely.
So the qualify, I think it's way too easy to say there are not, it's like actors. I can't find a black actor to play that role, which is what we were saying 25 mm-hmm. years ago. Yes, you can. You have to look, but they're there. We've got them, and they've been coming up through our observership and fellowship program, mm-hmm. you know, for the last 20 years. Sorry.
So let's close it up with Jennifer.
Well,
and
I'm going to add complication to this conversation because I think
it's been too simple.
I think a vital component to the challenges of being a young woman early career. I am an SDC associate member. I'm an Actors Equity member. I'm a SAG member. I have worked at Tim's Theater. I'm now a professor at UC San Diego, but I have children. And I cannot do those fellowships everywhere. And I can't, you know, and the support system that's not in place nationally in the United States at large in conversation for families and women having children, right? Like, it's reflected down and even more complicated here in the artistic setting, where even the idea of I wanted to bring my infant son with me, and even bringing him here was like there's not a system or support system in place. And I think that that's something that the union can really, like, you don't have to be an employer to help provide a support system for that, and maybe then get gender parity, because then women can, who are in that age range of the early career and also in the childbearing years, right, can figure out a way, because we want to have the career. I want to go through like even more stress and trouble and to do the work, but you know, I can't reproduce myself four times over.
Final comment.
Yeah, I just want to say on this issue, on all of these issues, you know, one part is like, what can we do as unions, as organizations that represent pieces of the theater? But a big part of it, we were talking about earlier, is like we're all with unions that are made up of members, right? And so having people who individually are raising these issues with us, but also with their employers and with, you know, others in the community is so important. And, you know, Lily, sort of the torch that you were carrying in the Bay Area around some of the issues recently. I mean, it's just having members who are willing to speak out about these issues is so important. And so I really, you know, I thank Tim for having this panel. I think it's great that you all came to raise these issues, because we're not done. We've got to keep fighting on these, and it is going to take all of us.
All right. So I'd like to thank Radar, Gail, Laura, and Shay. Thank you so much for broadening our perspective about the unions. You know, race is always a very robust dialogue, a very passionate one. And I think we can continue the conversation over wine. So the bus is picking us up at the Bricks, and it's gonna come every 15 minutes, 50 at a time. We're gonna go to Grizzly Peak Winery. You get two free drinks each, then we come back for Hot Asian Everything at 8 o'clock.
Thank you.